This is the first installment of What's All That Noise? First off, we're going to go and have a look at the anechoic chamber. Now, the anechoic chamber is one of the coolest places I have ever been in my life, and it is so weird. Then after that, we're going to do an experiment in the anechoic chamber with my lovely subjects, Rob and Jago. Rob says that he can tell just with his ears if there's something else in the anechoic chamber with him. First things first, let me introduce myself. My name's Ellie. I study acoustical engineering at Salford University, which makes me an acoustical engineer. Because I study acoustical engineering, I get to hang out in the quietest place on earth. Let's go have a look. So this is the quietest place on earth. And it's called the anechoic chamber, which literally translates to non-echoing. And so the reason it's like this is because all over the wall and the ceilings, and even on the floor underneath this wire mesh that I've got here, is covered in foam wedges. And these foam wedges absorb all of the sound that gets directed to it. Let me show you something. Okay, so listen to my voice as I turn around. Even though it gets quieter when I'm facing away from the camera, you can actually still hear my voice quite clearly. This is because when I speak to you, you can hear the sound that comes directly from my mouth to your ears, but you can also hear the sound that's being reflected from the ceiling and the floor and the walls. When I'm facing away from you, the reason it's quieter is because you can't actually hear any of the sound that's coming directly from my mouth. All you can hear is sound that's being reflected from the ceiling and the walls and the floor. Now listen to my voice when I turn around in here, the anechoic chamber. As you might be able to tell, when I'm facing away from the camera, my voice is actually a lot quieter. Now, this is because in the anechoic chamber, the absorbent wedges on the ceiling and the walls, and even on the floor underneath the trampoline bed, absorb all of the reflected sound.
Okay, so one of the other ways that the anechoic chamber is made to be the quietest place on earth is that it needs to be isolated from the outside world. So not only can no sound get out, but no sound can get in. So right now, we're in the gap that separates the anechoic chamber from the outside world. Now, the anechoic chamber is a room within a room. So as well as being isolated this way from outside, it's also isolated underneath. The whole room is suspended on these ridiculously strong springs all the way underneath at the bottom.
Okay, so let's recap. Sound that you can hear is made up of direct sound, which is sound that has come directly from the thing that made the sound in the first place. And it's made up of reflected sound, which is sound that's been reflected from the surfaces around you. I want to introduce you to Rob. Rob is a researcher here at Salford University, and he spends a lot of his time doing experiments in the anechoic chamber. He told me that he can tell, just from the sound of the room, if there's an object in the anechoic chamber with him. So I want to put this to the test. Obviously, Rob has a lot of experience in the anechoic chamber. I want to compare him with someone who maybe hasn't spent quite so much time in there. This is Jago. Jago is my friend from university, and he's also on my course, so he's another acoustical engineer, but he's barely spent any time in the anechoic chamber. So for our experiment, Rob is going to be our professional ears, and Jago is going to be our not quite so professional ears. So how is this experiment going to work? We want to see if our subjects, Rob and Jago, can tell if there's something in the anechoic chamber with them, just with their ears. So first off, we're gonna have to blindfold them. And secondly, we're gonna have to put a few objects in the anechoic chamber. So for this experiment, we're gonna use a mirror, paddling pool, a beanbag, and of course, the anechoic chamber. Why a mirror? The properties of a mirror are that it's hard, flat, and shiny. So because it's hard and flat and shiny, this means it reflects things really well. So this means that when the mirror is in the anechoic chamber, The prediction is that our subjects will find it quite easy to detect. Next, why a paddling pool? So the paddling pool is made out of plastic, so it's also quite hard and shiny. However, the surface of the paddling pool has a few different properties to the mirror. So the surface of the paddling pool is actually quite a lot more rough. Can you hear this? Also, the paddling pool has lots of circular dimples in it. Now, when sound or light hits an uneven surface, it doesn't necessarily just reflect straight back. Some of it gets split up and then it scatters out. If the reflections are going off in different directions, some of them might not hit their ears in exactly the same way. So it might seem a bit quieter. Although we're going to predict that our subjects will be able to detect this, it is going to be a bit harder for them. So now let's talk about the beanbag. So the physical properties of the beanbag are quite similar to a cushion. So as you can see, the cushion isn't hard and it's not shiny either. In fact, it's really quite soft. The prediction is when the beanbag is in the anechoic chamber, our subjects will find it very difficult to detect. So how's this test going to work? Each object is going to be put in the anechoic chamber 3 separate times. The reason we're going to do it multiple times is because then we can see if our subjects are just guessing or if they can actually tell. If they guess correctly for all 3 times that an object is in there, chances are they can probably tell. Also, we're going to put them in the anechoic chamber with nothing in there 3 times. This makes 12 tests in total. So for each test, they have 30 seconds to decide whether there's something else in there with them. Now, while they're in there, they can make any sounds that they like, although we'd recommend a clap or a click. Now, this is because a clap is a very short burst of sound. What this means is the original clap sound should have finished by the time the reflections get back to our subject's ears. Now, to make this a bit fairer on our subjects, we're also going to do a control test. Now, this is where our subjects are in the anechoic chamber with their blindfolds on, like they would for the normal test. However, they're fully aware that the anechoic chamber is empty. Now, this will get their ears used to the anechoic chamber because it is a very weird room. In fact, some people have reported being able to hear their internal organs working and their central nervous system. So they definitely need to get their ears used to it. So without any further ado, let's get started. So first the control test, and we need to blindfold our subjects.
You see anything?
No.
You see anything? Okay. How was that?
It feels so weird. My voice it sounds so dead.
Dead.
That's the only way I can really describe it.
So now both of our subjects are used to the anechoic chamber, let's move on to the actual experiment. First up is the paddling pool. So Rob is first into the anechoic chamber with the paddling pool, and let's see how he does. Oh, so Rob is going for the clapping technique first off. And his time is up. Let's see what Rob has to say. Okay, so do you think there was an object in the anechoic chamber with you?
No.
No, okay.
Oh, well Rob said no, so not a great start for Rob. Let's get Jogo in the anechoic chamber. Jago is also going for the clapping technique. Okay, and let's see what Jago has to say.
Okay, Jago, was there an object in the room?
I think so.
Jago said yes. Well done, Jago. So Jago is currently doing a bit better than our professional is. Next up, we have a mirror. So remember, both of our subjects should find this very easy to detect. And the verdict is...
And was there an object in the room with you, Rob?
Yes.
Yes.
Oh, Rob, that's much better. Right, now, Jago's up next.
Was there an object in the room?
Yeah, I could definitely hear it that time.
Okay, cool.
Well done, Jago. And next up, we have the beanbag. Okay, Rob's time is up. Let's bring him out.
I want to say yes.
Yes, okay.
That's very surprising. Rob thinks that there's something in there with him and the beanbag's in there. Let's get Jago in there. Okay, so Jago's time is up. Let's see if Jago can tell if the beanbag's in there.
Is he gone?
Yes, take it off. Was there an object in the room with you?
I don't think there was an object.
Okay.
Right, so Jago thinks that there isn't an object in the anechoic chamber because Rob guessed that the beanbag was in there and not the paddling pool. I'm starting to think that Rob is guessing more than Jago. This is pretty slow. Let's speed this up. So Jago's done wonderfully. He's followed our predictions down to the T. So he's guessed that the mirror was in there correctly all three times that the mirror was in the anechoic chamber. He also guessed that the paddling pool was in the anechoic chamber every single time it was in there. He never once guessed correctly for when the beanbag was in there because the beanbag is absorbing most of the sound. And he guessed correctly when there was nothing in there. Rob's answers, on the other hand, aren't quite so consistent. For the mirror, Rob guessed it was in there correctly twice. He guessed that there was nothing in the anechoic chamber twice when there was actually the paddling pool in there. And strangely, Rob guessed yes twice when the beanbag was in the anechoic chamber. And then again, even for when the anechoic chamber was empty, his answers weren't very consistent. He guessed correctly that it was empty twice and incorrectly once. So for the purposes of our evaluation, neither of our subjects should be able to tell if there's a beanbag in the anechoic chamber. What this means is if they said yes to there being an object when the beanbag was in the anechoic chamber, this is actually going to count as a wrong answer. So because of this, we're going to change Rob's results a little bit. So even though he guessed correctly for the beanbag twice, we're going to change this to him guessing incorrectly for the beanbag twice. Now this is because he shouldn't have been able to hear it. Now this also changes Jago's results quite considerably. It means that Jago guessed correctly every single time he went into the anechoic chamber. So just from looking at the results, we think that Jago can reliably detect objects in the anechoic chamber, especially if they've got the physical properties that make it easier to detect. And we're saying that Rob cannot reliably identify the objects. But I think we need to prove this with a bit of maths. Got my trusty calculator. Rob guessed correctly 6 times. So that's 22%. So that means that there is a 22% chance that Rob is guessing. So it cannot be said with certainty that Rob can detect an object in the anechoic chamber. In other words, Rob is probably guessing. So let's do the maths for Jago. This is 0.2% probability that Jago is guessing. So it can be said with certainty that Jago is not guessing. Or in other words, it can be said with certainty that Jago can detect whether there is an object in the room with him or not when he's in the anechoic chamber. Jago is our winner! And I hope he's very happy as well. That's all we've got time for today. Next time on What's All That Noise, we will be doing the giant cornflower experiment. This will be involving the giant shaker.